I have with me sitting here one of the most forceful and articulate members of the Senate, Senator Eugene McCarthy of Minnesota. The Senator is well known in the Midwest and has been a staunch and loyal Democrat in the Senate and a very firm supporter of the late President. Senator McCarthy, as a former college professor and as an author of a book, I believe it's called Frontiers in Democracy, what do you see as the repercussions domestically of the death of President John F. Kennedy?
Well, John, at a time like this, it really doesn't make much difference what you have been, or even what you expect to be. You pass a pretty harsh judgment upon the realities of the moment. I suppose one even feels somewhat guilty at even attempting to describe what's happened in language which might be remembered, because the harshness and the reality of the fact itself is such that if you need to really, and there's not much need for it, because I think everyone in the country has a very deep sense of what has happened, that to try to embellish it or to make it more clear to people is a task which probably should be left for the poets and for those poets who have restraint enough not really to touch this subject for 10 or 15 or 20 years.
Senator, there will be many distinguished foreign visitors attending the funeral, including President de Gaulle, Britain's Prime Minister Hume, Chancellor Erhard, and former Chancellor Adenauer. Do you think that even at this solemn, tragic moment that there will be some kind of inter-allied discussions at a summit level during their stay?
Well, I'm sure there will be informal discussions as to what continuing good may come of it. I think that at most one can only be hopeful. We are always, it may be an attribute of human nature to somehow accept that the death of a great man and of a strong man and of a man of real power, that this in itself has a kind of purifying influence upon history itself. I think it's good to believe that and to hope for that. But there are some contradictions in the testimony of history, that sometimes following the death of men devoted to peace and to liberty and to the pursuit of justice, that disorder rather than order has followed. It would be my hope that under these circumstances and in these times, this what appears to be an almost gratuitous sacrifice of a young man in the office of the presidency, not one who had in any way offended anyone, not one who had in effect had time really to prove himself that this might have a kind of purifying and a kind of redemptive influence upon not just the United States, where we're concerned about hate and suspicion and doubt and all of the forces of unreason, but that it might have an influence for good throughout the entire world.
Do you think that the forces of hate, unreason, and doubt that sometimes have been evidenced, even in our country, were in any way a contributory factor to the assassination?
Well, John, this raises the question of guilt, which upon which no one person really is ever qualified, or does he with any right speak. There is a disposition, I think, abroad in our country for people to pronounce judgment upon others and to say who is guilty and who is not guilty. I have always tried to restrain myself from passing that kind of particular judgment upon any man. But the guilt for the assassination of a president is a guilt which is so great that I don't think we can, just in the equation of human relationships and of human life, that you can say that this one man, whoever he may be, that performed the act, that he himself can bear that burden of guilt. And you have to look beyond that, and you say, well, who else contributed to it? And I suppose eventually you back up and you say, well, all of us, the city of Dallas, the state of Texas, the United States itself, and everyone, I suppose, who has wished ill to the President of the United States, everyone who in some measure may have envied him, but in a very particular way here in this country, I think that those persons and institutions that have, when doubt did exist, and all of us know that there are many doubts, many things about which we must be doubtful in the world today, that taking doubt, we've tried to expand it really, and on the basis of a doubt to create a very serious suspicion that anyone who contributed to the creation of that change or to bringing about that change must feel a very particular sense of guilt. In a time when everyone must be somewhat fearful because there are forces of evil abroad in the world and much uncertainty and ignorance, that anyone who, acknowledging that fear really lives only in shadows, if you have, in a sense, protected and kept this fear from the light until it developed into a kind of despair, what Franklin Roosevelt called a fear of fear, that these persons must bear a special measure of responsibility for what has happened. And all of these together, I suppose you'd have to accept, John, that there are probably 100,000 people in this country who are unstable enough and irrational enough and emotionally disturbed enough so that if properly stimulated, they might have performed the act which this man performed in Dallas, Texas. So you move off from that and say, well, now, who is responsible for creating conditions which would move these people to this kind of action? At that point, then I think each of us must look into himself to try to determine what measure of guilt he himself must bear for this, rather than to look outward and point the finger at others.
Thank you very much, Senator Eugene McCarthy. I've been talking with Senator Eugene McCarthy, Democrat from Minnesota.